agenda is on Wednesday. And then we'll head right into the alcohol chapter. Fun, right? Yay! Okay, so we talked about nitration and how we are going to take a benzene ring, or one of our other aromatic rings. Remember, aromatic means that you have what? A benzene ring, okay? And we're going to add nitric acid to it. And we said this right here, that right there, is the same thing as HNO3. They just write it like that in hopes that you'll see where the different components of it are going. So the NO2 right here on the end is hopping onto the ring, and it's replacing that hydrogen right there. And then the hydrogen gets together with the OH, and it makes what over here?
Water.
Yes. Okay, so then we get nitrobenzene. Alrighty, so what else do we notice up there? Well, we notice that nitric acid, this stuff right here, isn't enough, so we have to throw some sulfuric acid in there, the H2SO4. And what that does is it allows us to get an amino group onto this ring, and you guys can see down there, if we take nitrobenzene, and we do a first reaction with a metal catalyst right here. So we've got iron in there and a little bit of acid. And then we do a second reaction with some base. We can get NH2 from the NO2 right there. Okie dokie smokies. Alrighty. So up here it tells us that we've got iron, zinc, or tin that we will see for the reaction. And you just have to go, oh, okay. In this class, usually when we have a metal there, it acts as a what? A catalyst, all right? So these are useful for making antibiotics. And down here, we talked about the sulfa drugs and how they are popular for treating urinary tract infections and MRSA. But unfortunately, they give a lot of people gastric distress. And you can see up above there how one of these reactions might be written. So the first reaction would be your nitric acid and your sulfuric acid. And the intermediate product is going to be nitrobenzene. So it's going to be this guy with an NO2 on it. And then we've got the metal and the hydrochloric acid. And then you don't see the base at the end like we saw on the last slide. You get the final product right there with an NH2. Are you guys all right with this? Kind of, sort of, maybe? Okay. You gonna get an A++ on this portion of the exam?
Yes.
Oh yes, right. Okay. Alright, so that takes us from nitration to sulfonation. So in sulfonation, we're gonna be adding what kind of atom here?
Sulfur.
A sulfur, right? Some kind of sulfur. And what we have is we have benzene. And again, remember folks, that each of these carbons, you have a hydrogen. This hydrogen is just poking out right there for you to see, because whoever wrote this wants you to do what right there? Something, right? They want you to do something right there, right? Yeah, so it's saying right here, please do something. So what we have is we have sulfur trioxide and we have, what's H2SO4? Sulfuric acid. And together, sulfur trioxide and sulfuric acid are called something funny. They're called it fuming sulfuric acid. And it actually fumes. So you can see it fuming. And it's kind of some, really harsh and corrosive stuff, but if you need to get something done, you gotta force it done. So, yeah, so fuming sulfuric acid there. And what we get is something strange, because over on the last slide, this is pretty understandable, the way that it was drawn. You have an HNO3, and then one of your oxygens disappears, and you're like, all right, okay, it's an NO2. And then you go back over to this slide right here, and you're like, okay, I've got an SO3 there. So maybe on that side, it's the same thing as the nitration, and you get SO2 that's what that looks like. Just in case you're wondering, oh my goodness, I'd like to see the full structural formula of that SO3H right there. If I don't get it, my life will be forever, you know, not so great. All right, so why would we want to do this? Well, it's useful for making detergents. And we really like to wash our stuff, right, friends? We like to throw some detergent in the dishwasher and wash our dishes and into the washing machine and wash our clothes. And it's also useful in making phenols. And remember, a phenol is a benzene ring with an OH on it. If you just have a benzene ring with an OH on it, it's called phenol. But if you have variations with different things around the ring, it's called a phenol. It's one of the phenols. Is okay with that? Okay, right on. Okay, so if you have benzene sulfonic acid in there, and then you're like, oh, I'm not really happy with this product, I want to do something else with it. Well, you can. You can throw some base at it, so some NaOH, and you can crank up the temperature really high. Ah! And then you can do a second reaction with some acid, and then you're going to turn your SO3H into OH there. Are you guys all right with that? Okay. So another way you might see this written right here is OH minus, or it might just say base. And this right here, it might say heat or some other high temperature. Okay, so don't memorize that, like it has to be at 300 degrees Celsius. Just recognize, okay, we're throwing some base in there and we're really cranking up the heat on it. And I want to go back to this slide right here and show you that, friends. Sometimes when we have a base, we just put part of the base that we're interested in, which is the hydroxide, okay? What is the cation on there? Is it Na plus or is it K plus? We don't know because we're interested in this part of the base. This liquid right here, the H3O plus, you could put the specific acid you're using or you could put H plus, but whatever it is, we're throwing an acid in there. You guys all right with that? Okay, so if we look at this slide right here, it is kind of fuzzy. I need to get some better pictures in here. All right, what we can see is that we've got fuming sulfuric acid and we've got some kind of benzene ring with a long chain on it there. And this is a big number right here, so it's a long hydrocarbon chain. And what we're going to do is we're going to get SO3H on there. And then we're going to put base in there, and what you'll get is this thing with a big old tail and a polar head. So this part right here is polar. Can you guys at least see that it says SO3 minus and Na plus there? Okay, so that's telling you that's ionic. It's got charges. So if it's ionic, is it going to be attracted to water? If it's got positives and negatives, will it be attracted to water? Yes. So this side of the molecule right here is attracted to water. Now this portion of the molecule right here is nonpolar. There's the benzene ring and there's that big old hydrocarbon chain right there. Okay, so it's got CH2 in parentheses and then a big number down there like 7, 8, 9, 19, something like that. So what that looks like is this. We'll have a non-polar tail and a polar head. Does that kind of sort of look familiar? Mm-hmm. Okay, so if you have ever taken biology, you probably looked at a picture of a lipid bilayer. Does that sound familiar? Okay, so the tails like to point themselves at each other because they're all nonpolar, and nonpolar things like nonpolar things, right, friends? Mm-hmm. And polar things like polar things. So what happens is you get these micelles and the polar tails point themselves at each other and you get nonpolar solutes in the middle, okay? So So when we're going to wash clothes, or we're going to wash our dishes or wash our car, what we'll have is something nonpolar in the center here, and the nonpolar tails will point themselves this way. And usually in oil, we've got some dirt in there or something that's, you know, grimy, okay? So the nonpolar tails are grabbing that and surrounding that, and then you have the polar heads on the outside, and these polar heads are attracted to water. So water is surrounding them. So your detergent makes these little micelles. They grabs the oil and the dirt, goes like this, packages it, and then you rinse it off and you spray these little micelles away, and whee, goes the oil and the dirt. Yay! Right, friends? Yes. Okay, so that's how it's working. That's how your soaps and your detergents work. And it's also how the cell membranes in our body work. But you get bilayers, so you get these layers of the tails towards each other. You guys remember that? Mm-hmm. All right. So anyways, that's why this is important in chemistry, because we like soaps and detergents, and you have to do some reactions to get these things. Yay! Okay, so let's do some problems. The first one is working backwards, because we like to work backwards, right, you guys? It's called a retrosynthesis. Backwards. Okay, so we've got this benzene ring looking thing, and then we have an NH2 over here, and we have a CHO over here, whatever that is, or ugh. Okay? Now, we haven't talked about this, and it's in black. So that's indicating to you, like, leave that part alone. It's just over there for fluff, okay? And if you need to know what that looks like, this right here looks like this. And we'll get to those when we get to the aldehyde chapter. So we're going to do things called ketones and aldehydes, and they're fun. All right, so that part of the ring is going to stay the same. So we can draw it like this. If you want the CHO to show you what it's doing. Now what we want to do is we want to go, okay, what did we use to get to that with this stuff right here? So did we kind of sort of learn something that might give us an NH2 on a benzene ring? Maybe. Can you, like, remember that, like, passing you by on a slide? Maybe. Even if you don't remember exactly what happened, do you remember me at least teaching you that today? Okay, all right. So we've got tin right here, and that's probably acting as a what? A catalyst. So we've got a metal and an acid, and then we have a second reaction that's a base. And if you just go back in your notes, what you'll notice is something very similar right there. So what we have here is we have metal with some acid, and the second reaction is a base. It doesn't say NaOH or KOH or base. It shows it to you a little differently, but it's doing the same thing. And we have in our problem, we have tin instead of iron. And don't worry about the tin chloride part of it. Just notice there's a metal of some sort there. Okie dokie, Smokies? Okay. So we can see here that NH2 came from the nitro group. Are you guys all right with that? Okay. So what am I going to do on this problem right here? Yeah, you're going to draw the nitro group right there. Well, I've seen some version of this before. Okay, on the other one, it didn't give you the anion, but it did give you a metal, it gave you the iron, and it gave you OH minus. Okay, folks? Okay. All right, but we're not done, because we got to go back one step. And right here we've got nitric acid and sulfuric acid, and we said that's a really fun one. It's called fuming sulfuric acid. Mm-hmm. Okay. And if we go back draw the benzene in again. In this example right here, we have the hydrogen turning into the SO3. You guys all right with that? Okay. So, that looks a little different, but what are we missing here? Yes, then maybe so. You guys like need to sit with these slides for a little while, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah. There's a lot of stuff. Like, good thing on Wednesday you'll have your slides in front of you, right? Yeah, because there's no camera. So it's all right. You'll have your slides and you'll be like, okay, I can do this. I can do this. And you're not going to panic, right? Yeah. You're going to breathe. If it's on there, you would have gone over it, and it's okay, you guys. Okay. So, we've got HNO3, H2SO4, and how are we getting it? Anybody? Yes!
Can you walk us through it, like, forwards? Because going backwards, I'm just kind of lost.
Oh, sure. We all want to do it again?
Yeah.
Yeah, you're like, sure. Not really, but okay.
Okay.
Oh, what's that?
You just add N2 to number 20, or no?
Yeah, we were getting there, but let's, oh my goodness, I forgot your name. Yeah.
Oh, I'm Erin.
Erin. Erin wanted to do it again. So, we're just going to start over because Erin wanted to start over. So, we were kind of in the middle of the thought. So sorry. But Erin's like, wait, I'm lost. Let's start again. So, well, let's all blame it on Erin. All right, Erin, you interrupted our thought that we were in the middle of. So, go ahead. What do you want to do here?
I just feel like I don't really get across this either direction, but going backwards, I'm even extra lost. So, we can start at step one and explain how we go to step two?
No problem. Yes. When I was a student, the retrosynthesis, the synthesis, they always used to drive me crazy too. I'm like, can you just give it to me in the forward direction, please, okay? All right, so let's just start with the benzene ring, okay? You gotta start with something, you guys, so let's just plop a benzene ring down on the page. Is that all right with everybody? Okay. So, apparently there's something going on at this carbon and this carbon right here. Is everybody all right with that?
Yes.
And we said already that this we have fuming sulfuric acid, and what happens is we substitute an SO3H for that hydrogen right there. Are we all okay with that, friends? CHO that I squished in right there, friends, the same as this right here. So that C double bond O, and that's the H right there. We've got the SO3H right there. Okay, so then we're thinking, have we seen something similar to this? Right there, and so we're gonna put our nitro group right there. And that will help us out a whole lot. We don't have to go to that example that we were looking at that we stopped at right there to think about. And so Erin, you have nitric acid in your sulfuric acid right here, and you're adding the nitro group to it. And then if we have a metal and an acid and our base right there, that's something that we saw before. We saw the iron and the acid and then the base. And that makes it way easier. Lady, put on your glasses. Okay? Mm-hmm. Now the next one is definitely fuming sulfuric acid. Okay. Thank you, Erin, for that. I should probably go and like edit that part out of the video. Just so nobody knows that how bad my eyes are. Okay. So this one looks like kind of a beast, right, friend? Like, oh, I can't do that. But you can, don't worry. Just treat this like it's a methyl group, okay? So this is going to be a cyclopentyl group. So cyclo, and then it's got five carbons. So instead of cyclopentane, it's cyclopentyl because this is the bigger group down here. Now this ring right here, friends, is what? That's benzene. It's just a different way of drawing benzene. So you could put the three double bonds in there, or you could put the circle in there, because remember when we talked about aromaticity and how the electrons of the double bond go around the ring because of the shape of the ring, it's nice and planar. Kind of sort of remember that? Okay, good. All right, so this is just up here, a branch like any other branch. So you have methyl ethyl propyl, and we're going to add some fuming sulfuric acid. Okay, so this time, we'll have our SO3H. Now, does anything happen to that cyclopentane, friend? Well, no, because I drew it again, just exactly the same, right? Yes, no, maybe so? Okay. So somewhere on this structure, we're going to add SO3H, because that's what we do when we have So you could add it right here to one of these guys, and that would be an ortho position. You guys remember the 1-2 thing for ortho? You could add it right here, so it would be 1-3, which is called what? Meta. So that would be here or here. Or you could add it right here, which would be what? Para. So if you go on to take organic chemistry, you will learn that there are certain branches that will direct another branch to add at a certain place. Okay? So there's certain ones that will tell an incoming whatever, you're going to go ortho what I'm going to do is I'm going to say it's going to be easier for this one to add a para, because if something is trying to add in right here, this thing is pretty big with its hydrogens and stuff, and it's kind of getting in the way. So it wouldn't be as easy to get in right here as it would right here. And does that make sense for us if we talk about it spatially?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So what are we going to add on the end here, friends? We added SO3H on the end there, and now we're going to do another reaction with base, a high temperature, and then we're going to follow that up with some acid. Have we seen that before?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we have.
Mm-hmm.
Right there, right guys?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so your SO3H turned into what?
OH.
OH, good. So does the benzene ring change for our final answer? No, so we go ahead and redraw the benzene ring again. What about the cyclopentyl group?
No.
Nope, it's the same. And what's in the para position?
OH. So what's happening to like the sulfur? Is it just like burning off?
So what is happening to the sulfur? So, do you remember when we were talking about Markovnikov's rule and I was showing you what was happening behind the scenes and I said, don't need to know this? So, if we wanted to take a look at the whole thing of the mechanism, like what happens at each step or what we think happens at each step, and that would take up a couple of slides. So, if you want that, email me and I'll show you what's going on. But if I add too many of those things in, people are like,
okay.
And then everyone gets home and is like, do I have to memorize this? And yeah. So, okay. So are we all okay with this, friends?
Mm-hmm.
Do we think we can do a question like this if we have our slides in front of us? No? No, don't make me do this. Okay, no camera, you have slides. Is there a question right here?
Oh, no.
It's stretching. Okay, so how about hydrogenation? All right, so we talked about hydrogenation when we were talking about regular old alkenes and regular old double bonds. So here we have a molecule called stilbene. Doesn't matter if it's cis or trans, and we're going to add some hydrogen to it. And you have palladium right here. And palladium is acting as a what? As a catalyst. It's a metal, and that's what we're going to see over and over in this class. And it is on a carbon mount. That's what that C is. Now, if it's 25 degrees Celsius in chemistry, that's also known as what? Room temperature. Even if the room you're sitting in is not 25 degrees Celsius in chemistry, when somebody says room temperature, they mean 25 degrees Celsius. Okie dokie, Smokies? Okay. All right. So what's going to happen is each one of these carbons of the double bond is going to reach out and grab a hydrogen. So here it's unsaturated, here it is now saturated with all the hydrogens they could possibly have, those carbons. But what you notice about the double bonds and the benzene rings is what? Nothing happens because the benzene rings are what?
Stable.
Yes. Now, you can make them add those hydrogens, but you really have to twist their arms, okay? Because they don't want to. And what you'll notice down here is we have another metal. And if you don't have platinum or palladium, you have some kind of other metal, it's probably indicating to you that it is a more expensive catalyst that works a little bit better. Okay? So we've got Ni now, which is what?
Nickel.
And now notice the temperature here. So we went from 25 degrees to 175 degrees. So we've got a different metal catalyst, we have a lot higher temperature, and right now you guys are sitting probably into a little under 1 atm of pressure, just atmospheric pressure right now. Look at this pressure. We are really pressuring our benzene rings to add hydrogen. So they're like, we don't want to, ah! Okay? hydrogenate your benzene ring, you better have some pretty harsh conditions there in order to do it. Now, if we take a look at this last slide, and we look at this right here, this is delta H, so it's talking about the enthalpy or the heat energy that this takes to happen. And what you'll notice here is you have a plus. So what this is saying is that you gotta put a lot of heat energy in to cause that to happen. So to add a couple of hydrogens across a double bond and get that, you gotta really force it. But then look what happens here. You have negative values here. Because once you've taken one of these double bonds away, then you no longer have the aromaticity, or you no longer have the special benzene ring situation where you have the six electrons just kind of rotating around inside of the ring. So now, once you've taken care of this one right here, these two are going to behave like regular old double bonds, and they will be hydrogenated really easily. And this is telling you that heat energy is going out. So you don't need to heat it up and make it happen. It's just like, now it's given up because it's lost its aromaticity and its will to live. So it's like, whatever, okay, just take the rest of my electrons, okay? So this is super hard to do, but once you do that, bam, bam, it's really easy. And it's so easy that it's really hard to stop it there. It just goes, okay? You have to make that sound when you do your exam, okay? All right. Okay, friends, questions on this stuff? Okay, and that concludes anything that will be on the exam on Wednesday. So give me a second to pull up chapter 14, and we'll get rolling with that. Aren't you guys super happy about that? Woohoo! In geraniums. Those are flowers. Okay?
Putrid,
Okay.
okay.
You guys are like, no. Also, when we get to the carboxylic acid chapter, there's one that smells like barf. There's another one that smells like stinky socks. You'd be like, ooh, okay. All right, alcohols, things that you have seen before. Okay, so we've got methanol, ethanol, and isopropanol. So ethanol, this is our drinking alcohol. It's also called ethyl alcohol. We use it as a solvent. We use it as a fuel. Definitely as a beverage on Friday night and an antiseptic. So if you look at one of those hand sanitizer bottles, it probably has ethanol in it. Ethanol, we've got CH3, CH2OH. So you guys can see there's a hydrocarbon chain and it has what on it? OH, yes, and that's the definition up there. Okay, our alcohols are going to contain an OH, which is called a hydroxyl or a hydroxy group, and it's going to be connected to a saturated carbon, and it says sp3 hybridized carbon. So it means that that carbon doesn't have a double bond or a triple bond on it. Okay, so can you see how there's all single bonds around that carbon there, friends? Okay, so if you're like, saturated sp3, what on earth? Just means that the carbon doesn't have a double or triple bond. Okay? So, definitely important for solvents. Methanol, also called methyl alcohol, we talked about this when we were doing safety in lab about how ethanol, when it's used as a fuel or a solvent, it's taxed at a lower rate, so it's got methanol in it often. And you don't want to drink that because what does methanol do to you? It makes you blind. Isopropyl alcohol, also called isopropanol. This is rubbing alcohol. Most of us have a bottle under our bathroom sink that's been there since grandma put it there, right? Right next to the bottle of hydrogen peroxide that grandma put there, right? Yeah, we're like, oh my goodness, this expired in 1982, right? Yes, okay. Or is it just like me? Okay. All right, so definitely we use it as a disinfectant. We also use it as a solvent. And this one right here, friends, notice how you have a propane chain, okay? But we're connecting the OH to the middle right there. And when we have something like that, usually we call that an isopropyl group. Is this sounding familiar, friends? So now we have isopropanol. The OL is telling you that you have an alcohol. An alcohol means you have an OH group somewhere on your hydrocarbon chain. Okie dokie, smokies? Okay, methane. Methane is CH4. This one right here is methane. Oh, yes. Ethane is CH3CH3, but if we rip one of the hydrogens off and stick an OH there, it's ethanol. That makes sense? Mm-hmm. We're okay with that? Mm-hmm. All right, so a hydrocarbon chain with an OH on there somewhere, also called a hydroxy or hydroxyl group. Okay. What about if we have a benzene ring there? Well, we've seen this one before. So things are going to start coming back to us, and we're going to be like, oh, problem with this thing is that it mimics estrogen. So when you have the baby formula in the bottle that was made with bisphenol A, you get a little bit of like leakage into the milk. And at some point, lots of people were tested and it was found that like 93% of people had bisphenol A in their systems. So the babies from the baby bottles, and adults usually from the inside of cans, like soup cans and whatnot, will have bisphenol A in there and other plastics that we drink out of and whatnot. Now, you don't want to get an estrogen mimic into your endocrine system because that just messes everything up. So that's one of the components to our obesity crisis is the different kind of chemicals in our environment that are setting off the endocrine system and whatnot. And then you also get other things like early puberty or breast tissue in boys and things like that from it. So Europe had banned it way before we did and Canada. And now you'll see things on plastics that say BPA-free. Have you guys seen that?
Mm-hmm.
So that's what it's talking about here. And can you guys see how there's two phenol groups there?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's bisphenol A. Also, eugenol. Eugenol is a phenol. And we just saw eugenol, and it's coming around for you to smell it. It's the component, it's the molecule that gives cloves their smell, right? And that's a lovely smell. Especially if you take this class in the fall and you're like, oh, pumpkin spice is coming. Right now you're like, oh, warm weather is coming. Any questions on phenols, friends? They are phenomenal. Well, you have to deal with my horrible chemistry jokes. Okay, all right. So, how do we classify alcohol? Well, waiting for a sneeze. Okay, I guess it's not coming. If you have a primary carbon is connected to how many other carbons? Just one. And remember the R here means what? Just the rest of the molecule. There's something else over there. And if you have a primary carbon and it's connected to one R, that's got to be the carbon. So a primary carbon connected to one other carbon. A primary alcohol has the OH group connected to a primary carbon. A secondary alcohol has its OH group on a secondary carbon. And a tertiary alcohol has its OH group on what kind of carbon?
Triple bonded?
On a tertiary carbon. This carbon right here is bonded to three other carbons. Do you guys see that? Kind of, sort of, maybe?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's how we would classify them. Primary, secondary, and tertiary alcohol. In the lab, we're going to work with primary, secondary, and tertiary alcohols, and we're going to see what kind of reactions they do or they don't do. So if we're looking down here, we've got ethanol. So we have a carbon that's bonded to how many other carbons? Just one, and it's bonded to two hydrogens right there. So ethanol is a primary alcohol because the OH group is bonded to a primary carbon. You guys all right with that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now if we back up one, some methyl alcohol, the methyl group, CH3, because of what it is, it's not bonded to another carbon, but methyl alcohol typically behaves like a primary alcohol, just so you guys know. Okay? Yes, no, maybe so? Now over here we've got a secondary alcohol, so you can see that the OH is bonded to a secondary carbon. And a secondary carbon is bonded to how many other carbons? Two. It's directly bonded to two other carbons. Don't worry about this guy over here. It's directly bonded to two other carbons. And a tertiary alcohol over here, the OH is bonded to what kind of carbon? A tertiary carbon. That's why it's a tertiary alcohol. And this carbon is directly bonded to how many other carbons? Three. One, two, three. You guys all right with that?
Mm-hmm.
Can we have a quaternary alcohol?
Mm-hmm.
like, nope. Four's enough. That's it. Four's enough to come out. The single bonds. Are you okay with that? So, nomenclature. Aren't you guys excited to name some more stuff? So, interestingly enough, we have common nomenclature and we have IUPAC nomenclature. And common nomenclature is often still used with the smaller alcohols. For instance, methyl alcohol is the common name for what? Methanol. And ethyl alcohol is the common name for what? Ethanol. And isopropyl alcohol is the common name for what? Isopropanol. So IUPAC means methanol, ethanol, and isopropanol. Okay. So if you look here, you can see some of the common names. You do not have to memorize these. Alright? You do not need to memorize the structure of allyl alcohol. These are just examples for you. Okay? And we can see the new naming system right here. So 2-propane-1-ol there. And we've got cyclohexanol up here, also called cyclohexyl alcohol. And this right here should look familiar to you guys. That's a T. So you've got T-butyl alcohol. You guys see that? Kind of, sort of, maybe? I should draw that in. There you go. Is that better? So how do we do this for common names? So for common naming rules, this is typically used for really common alcohols, not the crazy ones. We usually just go ahead and do IUPAC for the crazy ones. So we want to identify the alpha groups, like methyl, ethyl, propyl. That's the alpha group. To which the hydroxy group is attached. The hydroxy group or the hydroxyl group is what, friends? That's your OH. Okay. And name this as a substituent. So if we have the alkyl group ethane, we rip off a hydrogen and we put on an OH group. That's going to change it to ethyl. And then we spot the word alcohol on the end. So right here, if we had CH4, we took off a hydrogen and stuck an OH on it. The methane goes to methyl, and then we say alcohol. You all right with that, friends? Okay. So if we had ethane here, took away the hydrogen and put an OH on there, instead of ethane, you have ethyl, slash alcohol. Okay, ethyl alcohol. Propyl alcohol, isopropyl alcohol. What's the difference between propyl alcohol and isopropyl alcohol? Where this is connected. So on a regular propyl, whatever's connecting to it is connecting to one of the end carbons. And with an isopropyl, whatever's connecting to it is connecting where?
Yes.
To the center carbon. So this O is bonding to this carbon that's in the center there. So we have 1, 2, 3 or 1, 2, 3. You guys all right with that?
Mm-hmm.
Kind of, sort of, maybe? Okay. Questions for me? Concerns? Complete. Okay. All right. So that was common naming rules. Now we're going to do IUPAC naming rules. Yay! So what we want to do is select the longest continuous carbon chain that contains the OH. It's just like when we did double bonds, and we had to have the carbons that had the double bond. So you want the longest continuous chain that has the hydroxy group connected to it. So we're going to derive a parent name by replacing the E of the ending with the OL for alcohol. So if you have a methane, you would chop the E off of it and plop on an OL, and it would go from methane to what?
Methanol.
Yes. Okay. So number 2 says number the chain other branches there, then we will go ahead and number and label what those things are. So right here we have a 5-carbon chain. So we put on 1, 2, 3, but that's shorter than 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And a 5-carbon chain, is called what? Pentane, but if it has an OH on it, it's gonna be what?
Pentanol.
Pentanol, and you guys can see that right there, pentanol. And we have to say where the OH is and where our other branches. And we're familiar with how to do like 2-methyl, right? Okay, so we put that on the front. 2-methyl and then 2-pentanol, and then 2 is indicating that your OH group is on the second carbon. And our UPAC says you can be a little more precise with this. You can stick this number in the middle of the word. So it's 2-methyl-pentan-2-ol. Okie dokie, Smokies. Questions for me? Okay, same thing with the one on the bottom, right? We want to figure out what the longest continuous carbon chain is that includes the OH. Then we can see it's just going to be this one right here. And are we going to number left to right or right to left?
Right to
left. We're going to go backwards because we want the OH to be on carbon number 1. Does that make sense to us? Okay. So we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Or we could have done 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Either way, you've got a methyl group right there on carbon number 5. So let me go ahead and number that so you can see it. Okay, so if we have a 6-carbon chain, it's usually called what?
Hexane.
So we're going to chop the E at the end and put what there?
OH.
So you guys can see that right there. Where is the hydroxy group? It's on carbon what?
1.
You see that right there. And we have 2-chloro and 5-methyl. And the chloro comes first because it has a 2 on it, right?
No.
Chloro comes first because why? It's first in the alphabet. C comes before M. You guys remember that? Okay, good, good. Some of you are like, no. I hope you figure that out for Wednesday. Okay. So, maybe some of you are like, what happens if we have a double bond and an alcohol on there, right? You're sitting there and you're like, that would be so much fun. I hope she does one of those, right? Well, here you go. There, it's right there. So who's taking precedence there, folks? The hydroxy group or the double bond? Yes, your OH, look at that. And IUPAC has to have some kind of system to tell you which one takes precedence for numbering, right? And there you go, up at the top. The carboxylic acid group, which we'll get to, we'll have a whole chapter on the carboxylic acid. Those tend to be stinky molecules. Those are going to take precedence. And then we have an ester. And it looks like that should be amide, but most chemists pronounce it amide. I know that's crazy, but that's how it is. And then nitrile aldehydes and ketones. I mentioned those during the lecture today. We'll get there, a whole chapter on that. Alcohols, there we are, right there. Alcohol, the OH group. And then ethers, we'll get to ethers soon. And then we have stuff that we've seen, alkene and alkyne. Now, notice that the alcohol is up there and the alkene is down here, so the alcohol has precedence over the alkene. Are you guys all right with that? Sounds hard, maybe? Gonna have to be? Yes, okay. So, longer be one that takes precedence, what happens is it becomes a branch, and it goes from having the O-L-N to going up front like a methyl ethyl or a propyl. And when it does that, it's called a hydroxy group up there, okay? And don't worry too much about that, okay? We'll get to a lot of practice on that later. Now, the one up at the top there, can you see how the triple bond takes precedence over the halogen, the chlorine there? Okay? So what you'll notice is that your triple bond, your alkyne, takes precedence over your halide there, okay, or your halogen. So that's why we number it backwards. So triple bond before halogen. Okie dokie, Smokies? Kind of, sort of, maybe? And don't worry, when you go to take this exam, you will have this slide for yourself. So you'd be like, okay, this one gets the ending. This one becomes a branch. And don't worry, we'll practice and you will have homework and you will be happy. Well, maybe not happy, but okay. Okay, so what happens when you have more than one of something? Greek prefixes, right? Di, tri, tetra. Yep, so same thing here. If you have more than one hydroxyl group, you're going to use Greek prefixes to indicate how many. And what's crazy here is all of a sudden the E comes back. So, like, if you just have one, it would be pentanol. But if you have two of them, the E comes flying back in from outer space, and it's like, now we are pentanediol. Ah! Why? IUPAC, right? You're so excited about that, right? Okay, yes. So what we have there is 2,3-pentanediol, because you have an OH group on carbons 2 and 3 of a 5-carbon chain. Okay, have you, Smokies?
Yeah.
Okay. How about naming phenols? So if you have a benzene ring with an OH on it, we're going to name the parent phenol instead of a derivative of benzene. So notice how right here, your parent name is phenol. So the OH group, because it's taking precedence, and we're saying this is the parent here, the carbon of the benzene ring that the OH is bonded to is carbon number what? Carbon number one. And then you have a choice whether to go counterclockwise or clockwise. Which way are you going to go? You're going to go clockwise, because then that would put your nitro group on carbon number two. So you have 2 and 4. If you went this way, you'd have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You'd have a 4 and a 6. So we're going to go 2, 3, 4. You guys all right with that? So we have 2, 3, 4 there. Okay, so we have 2,4-dinitrophenol. How in the list here, the alcohol takes precedence over your nitro groups. So this is saying that the alcohol portion of it is going to be the parent. Are you guys kind of sort of okay with that? And because the nitro groups are less important or have less precedence, those become the branches. So that's why the nitro groups are the branches, and the alcohol gets the parent. Because of this list right here, because you have to have some kind of standardization in naming. Are you guys all right with why this is dinitrophenol instead of the OH being a branch?
Yes.
Okay, good, good. Alright, so let's do some naming. So number one says name the following molecules. So we probably have seen these before. Does anyone want to try? Which one is that? We've seen it before. Yes. That one is p-butyl, what? Alcohol. So the common name on that one is p-butyl alcohol. And where did we see it before? Right there. Okie dokie, Smokey? Okay, so cover up what you just saw. Pretend you didn't see the IUPAC name there. And let's go back here and look. Do IUPAC. Okay, so IUPAC says we have to identify the longest continuous chain that has what bonded to it? The OH group. So we could do 1, 2, 3, or 1, 2, 3, or 1, 2, 3, or 1, 2, 3, but that OH is going to be bonded to carbon number 2, however we go. Do you guys see that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So let's do 1, 2, 3. Let's go down like that, which would make us have a methyl branch at carbon 2. Are you guys all right with that?
Mm-hmm.
If I went 1, 2, 3, would I have the same thing?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, because you'd still have a methyl branch of carbon number 2, and you'd still have that OH on carbon number 2. Okay, so just putting our thought process here, the parent is going to be a 2-propanol. Yes, no, maybe so?
Mm-hmm.
You guys want to call it isopropanol, don't you? Okay. So what's the branch? What's that branch?
2-methyl.
So if we put it together, we would have 2-methyl. Propanol. Does that match what that other slide said? Okay, so are we good with that? What else could we have called it that would look a little bit different? Just a slight change. Yes, we could have said propan-2-ol. Okay, does that make sense for us? So put this 2 right here, right next to the OL. IUPAC says if you do that, it's more precise. Okay, so we've got 2-methyl-2-propanol there. Now the 2 is telling you that the OH is bonded to that second carbon. You don't need to say the iso there, okay? 2-propanol. All right, so are we all okay with the common and IUPAC names for this guy right here? Okay. Looking at the one on the top right, is that a phenol?
Yes.
No.
It kind of looks like it. It kind of tricks you into that, right? What is missing there? The double bonds are missing. So be very careful, you guys, when you have cyclohexane versus benzene. Okay, so cyclohexane is just a 6-member ring. There's no double bonds. If you put the 3 double bonds in, then you've got a benzene. Alrighty?
Yeah.
Does anyone wanna take a guess at how I'll number it? Okay, I keep hearing OH. What about the OH? Yes, the carbon that the OH is bonded to is number one. Is that what we were all thinking?
Mm-hmm.
If it wasn't, we are now, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we've got number one here. And does it matter which way I go around the ring?
No,
because his methyl groups are going to be on carbon number four. Oops, not one. Bad teacher, bad. Okay. And if I just keep numbering because I can't see right away how many carbons I have in that ring, I can see that there are how many?
Six.
So that's some kind of cyclohexane there. Now, if I have an OH on it, it's going to go from cyclohexane to what?
Cyclohexanol.
Okay, so that's going to be our parent right there. We can make it one cyclohexanol or cyclohexane one all if we want. But remember, we have a ring structure. And whatever we have on the ring that takes precedence is going to be always on carbon number what?
One.
Okay. Are we all right with that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So our branches are what and what? Methyl and methyl. And they're both on carbon what?
Four.
So I'm going to start this name with what?
Four.
Okay, 4, 4, because remember, you've got two branches there. If you've got di, you need two numbers. If you have tri, you need how many numbers?
Three.
Good. Okay, so we have 4, 4. Keep going. I heard someone say it.
Dimethyl.
Cyclohexanol. And again, you can put one cyclohexanol or cyclohexane one all. Yes.
Instead of putting 4, 4, could you put para or no?
On this one, you don't do that because it's not a benzene.
Okay.
So ortho-meta-para, that's a very good question. Ortho-meta and para is very specific for benzene rings that have two substituents. So that's one that trips students up a lot, is cyclohexane versus benzene. So watch out for that, my friends, okay? Are we okay with this IUPAC name?
Mm-hmm.
Now this one is not a simple alcohol, so we don't have a common name for this that anybody I know has memorized, okay? So we just go with IUPAC on this. Yes?
That was my question. So there was no common for this,
This one right here?
Uh-huh.
That the common name for that was T-butyl alcohol.
And then for the next one, we don't have any common name.
No, because the common names are for the common alcohols. The smaller ones, you know, we see all the time. Okay? All right, friends. Classify the molecules above based on level of substitution. So do we have a primary, secondary, or a tertiary alcohol? On T-butyl alcohol, friends, primary, secondary, or tertiary alcohol?
Tertiary.
Good. Tertiary, because that carbon is what kind of carbon?
Tertiary.
The OH is bonded to a tertiary carbon. Over here, the OH is bonded to what kind of carbon?
Secondary.
This carbon is bonded to two other carbons. That's a secondary carbon, so this is what kind of alcohol?
Secondary
alcohol. Does that make sense to us? Want some of those problems on the next test?
Yes.
Okay. All right. So number 3 says, and I put those carbon problems on your test. I've only got like 7 or 8 questions done so far. I really gotta like hurry up tomorrow. I put the classify the types of hydrogens and carbons on there. Thinking, oh my goodness, everyone's gonna get like A+ on this section. And every time I think something's super easy, you guys are all like, I was tricking, it was hard. So anyways, study those ones. Know what kind of carbon you have, what kind of hydrogen you have. All right, so draw the following molecules. We've got 1, 2, cyclobutane diol. So what do you wanna start with for this one? Does it matter where I put carbon one?
No.
No, pick a carbon because you have a ring structure here, and wherever you put it, you just put the other OH on an adjacent carbon. So if I wanted to put my first OH here, I could go up or to the left with the other OH, right, friends?
Mm-hmm.
So right here, I've got 1,2 cyclobutane diol. Are we okay with that?
Mm-hmm.
You could have put your OHs here and here. You could put them here and here. You could put them here and here. Just as long as you don't put one here and one here. Okay, friends? You don't want 1,3. You want 1,2 there. Questions for me on this? Okay, last one, and then we're out of time. Perfect timing on that. 2-ethyl-3-methylphenol. What are you going to draw first? The phenol. Yes. And phenol is a benzene ring with what on it?
OH.
With an OH. When you're drawing this, don't forget your double bonds. Common student mistake, just draw cyclohexane. Okay, we've got phenol there. Then I want to stick a what on there? An ethyl or a methyl. Either way, probably easier to start with an ethyl because that's just the next carbon over, right, friends? This carbon right here is carbon number what?
One.
So if you have 2-ethyl, you could go this way or this way. Does that make sense to us? Okay, so if we're drawing line bond, we just want to go CH2, CH3. Are we okay with that?
Mm-hmm.
Does anyone need me to actually draw in CH2, CH3?
Mm-hmm.
I can if you want.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, then it says 3-methyl. So where do I go?
Down.
You would go down because you want 1, 2, 3. If I had put my ethyl right here, then I would put my methyl there. Are we all okay with that?
Mm-hmm.
What does methyl look like if we're doing line bond?
Just
a stick, yep, just a line. And we know that there's a CH3 at the end of every line there. So here you have CH2, CH3, here we just have CH3. Are you guys okay with this?
Mm-hmm.
Not too bad? Okay. Again, for Wednesday, friends, whatever's in your notes and on your homework is what's going to be on the exam. If I didn't teach it to you, don't worry about it. That's not how I test, okay? If I mentioned it in lecture, I